There are two parts to the counselling process. The first half is absolutely necessary. What is that? It is the process whereby the counsellee gets in touch with the counsellor, builds that rapport and that contact with the counsellor, builds that trust, and then decides to pour out. Very often the counsellee comes out with a lot of deep issues, sometimes things which are held up for a very long time inside the mind of the person. And as he or she goes on and on and on talking, what happens is that there is a lightness, there is a feeling of being relaxed, there's a feeling that I have somebody who cares for me, somebody whom I could share with, somebody who understands me, etc. In a lot of cases, that itself is a process of empowerment. A person gets so empowered that the person now feels, yes, I can handle life. So the first thing I want the counsellor to be aware of is, not every counsellee requires goal setting. Many counsellees, once the catharsis is over, feel comfortable enough and empowered enough to proceed with their own life. And it's the duty of the counsellor to encourage them to do that. So what we do is that when you come to that stage where you feel the catharsis, the pouring out, the emptying out is over, and the person is now comfortable with his or her own emotions and thoughts and this and that, give a little gap. Give a little space, allow that person to think, say that, okay, let's take a break in the counselling for a little while. Go and think over what are your alternatives, what you can do and things like that. Then when the person comes back, and if the counsellee specifically says, I want your help, I want to take some decisions, I want to set some goals for myself, I want to make some progress in life, that's when the counsellor needs to start the process of what we call as goal setting. The first principle of goal setting in non-directive counselling obviously is, the goal should be set by the counsellee and not by the counsellor. Once that is drilled into a counsellor and imbibed 100%, the process or the stages go this way. The first thing that the counsellor should do is to check out and ask the counsellee, are you ready for change? What is happening to you in life, you're not very happy with it, things are not going well, you're not feeling fulfilled, or you're feeling confused, or you're feeling even depressed. Are you ready to be proactive, take some interest in yourself, take some initiative, and bring about some change in your own way? Some counselees don't like that. They like to put the blame on somebody else and say, no, only if the other person changes, then my life will be better. That's where the counselor has to stop and go on working with the counsellee to ensure that the counsellee comes to that state of mind where he or she says, yes, I am the one who is suffering, I am the one who needs to have a better quality of life. So I will take the initiative and I will do something about it and I will improve. Once that hurdle has been crossed, the second thing that the counsellor does is to check out, what have you already done in terms of resolving your issues? Tell me all these days, what are the efforts that you made? Did you succeed? Did you succeed partially? Did you not succeed? Did you feel that it was left halfway through? That itself gives the counsellor some idea about how far the counsellee has reached and from where he needs to be taken forward. Then even at that stage, even though the counsellee may be saying, come on, you tell me what to do. You are the counsellor. I've come here for help from you. I've come here with a lot of expectations that you will give me a guidance or a direction or an advice. The counsellor doesn't say, I will not give you advice. All that the counsellor does is to say, yes, I will help you, but let's start listing down the options and then we'll narrow down to which is the best option. So you tell me first, what do you think are the options open to you? In some cases, the counsellor may be so confused that he says, no, I'm sorry, I'm totally muddled up and I really don't know what to do. In some cases, the counsellee may say, yes, I can think of option A or option B, but I'm not very confident or I'm not very sure which one to take. So what the counsellor does is, okay, now that you have option A or option B, or now that you have said you have no option, what we will do is we'll explore all other alternatives. And that's where the skill of the counsellor comes in, to be able to help the counsellee think outside the box. The counsellor helps the counsellee to think that life is not just in black and white. There are various shades of grey. Either or, fight or flight are not the only two options. Yes, those two are there, but then there is a third and a fourth and a fifth option. So go on exploring with the counsellee. Do you think it is possible to do that? Have you ever thought of the possibility of this? Do you think that it will help if you bring about this change or do this activity? That's how you start expanding. Make it into as wide a list as possible. Then tell the counsellee, okay, now let's start shortlisting from this. Maybe there might be one odd which he says, no, this is not practical, I can't do it, you can remove it. Maybe there's something which doesn't suit the value system of the counsellee and says, no, I think ethically this is not right, I wouldn't like to do it, cancel it. Maybe some option is not in his control, no, I can't do it because it's not in my control and I don't know whether the other person will do it for me or not, I can't force that person to do this, cancel it. Start narrowing down. Whatever the number of options that are left over, the counsellor will then tell the counsellee to prioritize. If there is one or two or three or four options left, can we put them in an order of priority? First preference, second preference, third preference, etc. And then tell the counsellee, come on, now let's start with your first preference. How would you like to do it? Again, make the counsellee come out with the logistics, the time schedules, all these things. Encourage the counsellee to set some time limit. Go ahead with the counsellee to work out the logistics. Ask the counsellee what resources you will be needing for this and are those resources available to you. That's how you go on narrowing down and specifying. Once the counsellee has set certain goals, set some targets, has set some sort of time limit, again the counsellor takes a step backward, allows the counsellee to move on, sets maybe some time period or something where you will come back for a feedback or something. Tells the counsellee, if you don't succeed in whatever you are doing, don't hesitate, don't feel embarrassed. Come back and tell me, yes, I had agreed or I had volunteered that I will take up this action, but somehow I'm not being able to do it, I can't bring about it, or I'm trying it but it's not succeeding. Please feel free to come back, we'll move on to option 2 and option 3 and all that. That is how the whole process of goal setting goes. And then comes the monitoring and this and that, which we'll talk about later.